Okay, I'm going to solve these equations symbolically. Since the first one has fractions, I'm going to use the lowest common denominator to reduce the fractions and get rid of them. So 6 looks like it'll work for this problem because all denominators 3, 2, and 6 are divisible by 6. Once I make sure the left side and the right side get multiplied by 6, some reducing occurs conveniently. And now I can end up with just a 2 in the numerator and an x plus 1 left minus 1 times 3 is 3 equals 6's are gone, 3x minus 3. So just in the first step, we were able to wipe out the fractions. After that, we just simplify as usual. Combine like terms, and we have 2x minus 1 equals 3x minus 3. I'm going to go ahead and subtract 2x from both sides. That's going to be negative 1 equals x minus 3. And if I add 3 to both sides, we get x equal to 2 as our solution. The second one, part B, has decimals. And while you can choose to work with the decimals, I suggest that you eliminate them. And you'll make less mistakes that way, probably. Since there's one decimal place here and one decimal place here, and nothing really with the 2, I don't care about that one. I just look at these two and I think, if I multiply them by 10, the decimal will move over 1 and I won't have to deal with it anymore. Remember, 0.7 is the same as 7 tenths. So I'm going to multiply each chunk by 10. Whatever you do to the left side, you must do to the right side as well. And when I do that, this is going to become 0.7 is going to become a 7 and 0.8 is going to become an 8. And when you do this, and 10 times 2 is 20, make sure you multiply each chunk by 10 or 100 or whatever multiple it is that you're using. And make sure in this middle term right here that the 10 either gets multiplied by the decimal or gets distributed into the binomial. And since that'll just create more work for me and my intention was to eliminate the decimal, I just multiply the 10 by the 0.8 and not the y minus 1. Hereafter, we just simplify. So 7y minus 8y minus times a minus 8 and negative 1 give us a positive 8, it looks like, equals 20. 7y minus 8y is minus 1y. I'm going to subtract 8 from both sides. That's negative y equals 12. And then let's get a positive y, divide both sides by negative 1. So it looks like y is going to be equal to negative 12. Example 2 says, fill the table, then use it to solve the equation. And this is actually done numerically. Before, up here, when I did the algebra, it was done symbolically. Now, I'm going to solve this equation numerically. So it asks me to fill the table using this equation that's given right here. And we're only worried about the expression on the left, which is 3x plus 2. So the first one's already done for us. If x is negative 2, 3x plus 2 is going to be negative 4. Let's do the second one. If x is negative 1, we're going to take negative 1 and put it in place of the x and see what it spits out. And it looks like it gives me a negative 1. We're going to do the same thing for the 0. Well, if I plug in a 0 for place of the 3, that's just going to spit out a 2. If I plug in a 1, that's 3 times 1 plus 2, which is 5. And if I plug in a 2, 3 times 2, 6, and 2 is 8. So I have the table filled, and then I analyze the original equation. It says, in words, when is 3x plus 2 5, or equal to 5? And if I go and I look at my table, when is 3x plus 2 equal to 5? Well, right here is when it happens, so that x value must be 1. Therefore, the solution to this problem is x equals 1. All we did was pull it out of the table. If I were to solve this algebraically or symbolically like I did for example 1, I would still get x equals 1. Now, part B asks the same thing. When is this expression equal to this expression? In other words, solve that equation symbolically, not symbolically, I'm sorry, numerically by making the table. So they gave us the values. If x is equal to negative 1, what is going to be 4x minus, or 4 minus 2x? So let's go plug in negative 1 for 4 minus 2x. I'm putting that in red to distinguish it. 4 plus 2 is going to give me a 6. The next one, 4 minus 2 times 0, is going to give me 4. And the next one, 4 minus 2 times 1, is going to give me 2. Now I've done the other ones in blue. If I put a negative 1 for x plus 7, this expression, I get negative 1 plus 1 plus 7, which is 6. And then I put in a 0 for that expression, I get 7. And I put in a 1 for that expression, and I get 8. Now again, the original equation says, when is this guy equal to this guy? Well, we computed the red stuff, we computed the blue stuff. When are they equal? It looks like they're both equal right here, which means the answer will be the x value of negative 1. And again, if we were to solve this symbolically and isolate x, we would get x equals negative 1. Example 3, parts A and B says, an linear equation is solved graphically. Let y1 be the left side and y2 the right side, and find the solution by just looking at the graph. So I'm going to do exactly what they tell me. y1 is the left side, y2 is the right side. Well, y2 is just negative 3 from the graph, and y1, it looks like from the graph, is x minus 1. And what is the solution of this? I could do this algebraically and see that x is equal to negative 2, but that's not what I was supposed to do. I was just supposed to do no work and look at the graph. Now, when I'm looking at the graph, when is the y value of the blue line equal to the y value of the red line? And that happens right here, which, if you notice, has an x-coordinate of negative 2, which is what we got algebraically. Now, in part 2, I'm just going to go ahead and do it graphically like they say. When is the y value of the pink one the same as the y value of the blue one? Well, the y values are the same right here, which happens to be the place x equals negative 1. And if I were to set those two expressions equal to each other and solve, I would get x equals 1. Find the intercepts of the graph and then graph the line. So intercepts, there are two. There's an x-intercept where it crosses the x-axis, and a y-intercept where it crosses the y-axis. When it crosses the x-axis, y is always 0 here, and when it crosses the y-axis, x is always 0 here. So automatically, these two pieces of info go together. So I'm going to use this given fact. If y is 0, the y part of this equation completely drops, and I get negative 3x equals negative 6, which means the x-intercept is 2, or the ordered pair I get is 2, comma, and the 0 from up here, which I knew was a fact, the x-intercept always has a y value of 0. So if we do the same thing to find the y-intercept using this idea that x must be 0, plug it in, solve for y, we get y is negative 1.5, or as an ordered pair, x, remember, is always 0 for the y-intercept, and the y-coordinate is negative 1.5. Now let's go graph the line. 2, 0 says x-intercept of 0. I'm going to make my ordered pair there. And y-intercept negative 1.5, so down below negative 1, and then between right there, negative 1 and negative 2 is negative 1.5, and here is my line. You can find more ordered pairs if you want by choosing some other x and y values, but it says use intercept. So I found the x-intercept, the y-intercept, and I drew the line. Okay, example 5 says, in 1970, there were 1.1 million college degrees awarded, and then this number increased to 1.9 million in 2010. We're supposed to find a linear function d that approximates the degree numbers in millions x years after 1970. So that's important. It says after 1970, which means time sort of begins for us in 1970. So because of that, I have the ordered pairs 1970, which is the initial time since it said after 1970. So that's going to be my 0 for the year. That's when things start. And the y-coordinate is going to be the 1.1 million. On this side, 2010, well, how many years after 1970 is that? That's 40 years later, 30 years to get to the year 2000, another 10, 40 years later. Now it has risen up to 1.9 million degrees awarded. So I'm going to use these two ordered pairs to find the slope that will lead me to a linear equation that part A is asking for. So the slope, we'll say, is 1.9 million minus 1.1 million, remember vertical change or the rise or the change in y, over 40 minus 0. And when we reduce that, we're going to get 0.02 for the slope. So we got the slope, and if we know that the general equation in slope-intercept, let's say, is y equals mx plus b, if I have the y-intercept and the slope, I'm pretty much good to go. In this case, right now, I have the slope, so I'm going to put that as 0.02. And I also have the y-intercept, notice, since this x-coordinate is 0, 1.1 must be the y-intercept. So I put in the 1.1 for my y-intercept. But I'm going to adjust my variable from y to d because the problem said d is the number that approximates the number of degrees. X is the years after 1970. So basically the y-intercept kind of tells us the initial amount of degrees awarded, which was the year 1970, which for us is really where things begin, which is the zeroth place, let's call it. So this is the equation that describes the situation after 1970. Part B says interpret the y-intercept, so we know this guy represents the y-intercept of this graph. I have my x-axis and my d-axis. I know in the 1970 where we called it to be 0, I have, let's say that's 1.1. I'm going by 0.1s on my d-axis. And then 1980 I could potentially estimate using the equation, but I'm going to go ahead and use what happened in 2010, which was 40 years later, was 1.9. So 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Let's say that's 1.9. So I just have a rough sketch of a very, very rough sketch of what's going on. And notice the y-intercept is basically tells us that in 1970, or initially, 1.1 degrees were awarded. Part C says when symbolically estimate there were 1.7 million degrees awarded. So I'm going to symbolically, meaning using my equation, figure out when that happened. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take 1.7 million and plug it into D and find out what corresponding x value it has. So when we solve that equation, we get that x is equal to 30. In other words, 30 years later, or after the initial time of 1970, there were 1.7 million degrees awarded. Well, 1970 plus another 30 years later gets us to the year 2000. So what they're interested in is when were there 1.7 degrees awarded? That would be the year 2000. It's 30 years later than 1970. I could also actually kind of guess this from the graph. If I had an accurate, more accurate graph, I could say, well, 1.7 is here on the vertical axis. And if I go across and see what year that would be, if I had an accurate graph, you would see that that lands in the year 2000.